Welcome back to Alumni Field. It's Friday, March 17th. It's a beautiful evening for baseball. The time changed last weekend. The doldrums of winter fade away and spring is in full bloom. It's early in this baseball season. Southeastern, though, sitting tied for the best record in the Southland Conference. They're 3-0 right now, and we see them in the infield. Dylan, Mac Scroller, tell me a little bit about him.
Oh, man, he's 3-0 right now in the season. Their ace pitcher definitely deserved that Friday night start. He got drafted last season, actually, but came back to be the ace pitcher. It's crazy. Whenever you get drafted, whenever you're the ace pitcher of a really dominant program, you think you're the best pitcher in your family. Well, for Mac's case, he's not, actually. He's still the third best. He has two uncles. One is Brett Laxton, and the other you might have heard of, Ben McDonald. From both pitchers from LSU, Ben McDonald was the number one overall pick in MLB draft. Brett Laxton pitched a complete game in the College World Series against Wichita State for LSU. So, Max definitely have a family history.
That's quite the baseball family right there, Dylan. Dylan, you see this crowd here tonight at Alumni Field. It is a great atmosphere for a baseball game. In fact, since Matt Reiser has been named head coach, an average of 1,000, almost 100 fans have passed through the gates of Pat Kenealy Diamond here at Alumni Field. And that's a pretty good average, and it's actually best in the Southland. So people come out to support this the Southeastern Lions team. You see him foul one right there.
Yeah, definitely. He's definitely changed his program around. He's a young coach, and he definitely has the attention of not only his players, but the whole university.
Right now, up to bat is Cutter McDowell, leadoff hitter for Lamar here.
Yeah, Cutter's hitting 267 for the year. Just middle of the average guy, great leadoff hitter, gets on base a lot. Definitely good at that first spot.
He ranks fifth in the team in batting average currently. This is a Lamar team who is actually hitting better on the season than Southeastern as a team. They have a better overall batting average. They're batting 259 compared to Southeastern's 247. Another cold strike there.
We got a chance to talk to Coach Reiser before the game, and he describes this Lamar team as a team with power. He said they will hit home runs for days, and the wind right now is blowing about 10 miles an hour.
A shot deep in center field, going back just over the head of the center fielder. He slips. McDowell's going to sit at second base for a double. A drive right there. You just talked about the wind, and you have to think that played a factor in him misjudging the ball right there.
Absolutely. It was like perfect timing there. It seemed like I've sensed that. But center fielder is playing up there. And like you said, the wind's blowing about 10 miles an hour out to center field, and that ball is just going to keep carrying center fielder Byers.
That was Jacob Seward.
Yeah, Jacob
right
Seward
there.
Just couldn't catch up to it, and the wind will play a big factor. So most pop-ups that are usually outs might go over the fence or might go over the fielder's head, just like you see there.
Solid way to start off the game for Lamar. We saw it in pregame warm-ups and practice. They were hitting balls the outfield, trying to get these outfielders accustomed to this wind, and they were struggling even in the pregame here. Now up to bat, we have a Mr. Cole Coker. He's a star freshman player for this Lamar team. Lamar has two freshmen starting. Lays the bunt. It's going to go foul.
Yeah, you mentioned the duel for the freshman duo for Lamar. Cole Coker has been great and definitely got the attention of the team, and that's why he's a freshman starter. Southeastern has no freshman starters in their lineup. But an interesting note about Cole Coker is he's a communications major just like we are. And if Major Leagues doesn't, work out for him, he wants to be a broadcaster for MLB. So
he could join us up here, huh?
Anytime.
No call there. Hear the fans here in the stadium.
Baseball fans always the best, always the most rowdiest.
No, most definitely. Here's Coker now. Like you said, he's a freshman. A lot of transfer players on this Lamar team. Coker is not one of them. Another solid shot deep. Seward using his glove as a shield. Going to try and tag up. It's great. His cutoff, man. Great job there by Seward.
You just hit a great job there. That was a great job from getting the ball from the glove after the catch and making the quick throw to the infield to make sure the runner does not advance there. Great job there from the center fielder.
Seward making up for the previous misfire. And again, can't really blame him too much considering the wind is pretty crazy out there. Now up to bat, number 17, Reed Russell. And this is a guy we're going to be talking about all night long. Like you said, he hits for power. He also has the second best batting average on the team. So he's hitting for power, and he's also hitting for average.
Yeah, definitely left off right where he was last year. 2016 Southland Slugger of the Year, led the team in home runs with 18, actually tied a team record with that. Total bases, second on the team in RBIs, definitely a power hitter.
Scolden now looking back, trying to keep the runner at second, honest. Swing there and a miss.
Yeah, you can see right there, Mac threw a slider. That's something Mac's really good at. He can throw the fastball, changeup, slider, and curveball all effectively. And that's really good because it keeps hitters on their toes. You know, if Russell right here is thinking changeup, he'll throw that slider right there. If he's thinking slider, he'll throw that fastball, or he'll throw that changeup. So it's definitely effective, and it's definitely why Mac is on the mound Friday night.
See Scroller here, two balls, one strike now on Russell. Russell's someone who, again, swings for power, and he swings hard. He doesn't strike out very often. Scroller, one of the leaders in the conference in strikeouts, and the leader for the Southeastern team. It's going to just drift out of play there. Going to bring up two balls and two strikes now on Russell.
You hit it there. He doesn't strike out a lot, which is rare for a big power hitter. Normally, if you swing for the fences, you strike out a lot. But that's what makes Reed Russell very special, is that he does not strike out a lot, and he still has a great batting average, great home runs, great stats.
18 RBIs on this young season, and you'd think he'd like to bring one in now. Get this Lamar team started off hot. A cold swing. First strikeout of the night.
Great fastball there. Great fastball. Elevated it. And Reed Russell is just a little too slow to catch up to it.
We talked about in the pregame with Coach Reiser is you want to take advantage of this aggressiveness from this Lamar squad. They are very aggressive.
Absolutely.
When it comes to swinging the bat. Scrolling now looking back. Here's the pitch. Foul that one off.
Every time you see a foul ball that comes away, you just kind of want to like reach out and catch it, but
sadly, we are in this box. Imagine there's some kid chasing that ball down right now.
They got a neighborhood right behind this stadium, so I'd always kind of be scared. You know, maybe one day you're sitting in the living room watching a baseball game on TV and a foul ball comes flying through your window.
Not a way you want to spend a Friday evening trying to get someone to fix your windows.
Souvenir.
Two strikes now on the batter. Two outs after that leadoff hit. The leadoff double. Lamar trying to make something of it.
Good job by the Lions doing, you know, after the leadoff double to keep the man on second base. I'm sure Lamar would definitely like to capitalize on that, though.
This is Robin Adams here. He is from the Bronx, New York City. He's batting 368. That is the best batting average on this Lamar Cardinals squad. Last year, he actually led all freshmen in the Southland Conference in the home run category. He had six home runs. That was the best in the conference among freshmen. Again, playing into the idea that this is a powerful lineup.
Robert Adams, actually, like you said, he's a freshman, and he was an All-American in high school. His families also have a major league background. His cousin was signed by the Cleveland Indians from the Dominican Republic.
A lot of baseball in here. Then that's a drive into left center. The runner from second's rounding third, and he's going to be at home. Giving them their first run of the game. Solid shot there from Robin Adams.
Great contact right out the reach of the shortstop there, and it drives in the first run of the game.
13th RBI of this season for the leader in batting average for the Lamar Cardinals. Scroller now. An earned run. Hasn't had too many of those this season.
After getting two outs after the leadoff double, he was not able to get the third one there. And Lamar capitalizes.
Scroller, before the start of this game, six earned runs make that last his seventh. No one count now, two outs. Shot up the middle, off Scroller's glove, one-handed pickup and a shot to first for out three. Lamar capitalizes on the leadoff double. We'll be right back with more baseball. You're watching the Southeastern Lions here, the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field here. Ryan Byers, number six, leading off for Southeastern. Southeastern finds himself down 1-0 early in this ball game. After Lamar capitalized on a leadoff double from Gunnar McDowell, drove in that one.
Ryan Byers, a local kid right down the road from Ponchatoula High School. He's a redshirt senior.
On the mound for Lamar is Tanner Driscoll, who is had some struggling performances early in this season, just 1-2 on the year with a 4.44 earned run average. Trying to rebound from a tough start at Sam Houston State. Again, this Lamar team was swept by Sam Houston State, the perennial favorite. That's a high shot deep to left field. Left fielder's running out of room, and I think it's gone, and it is! A leadoff home run for Ryan Byers. He rounds the bases, cuts that deficit.
We called it before the game. Might see a few home runs, and there we go right there. Southeastern gets a leadoff home run from Ryan Byers.
And just like that, the game's tied up.
Second home run of the year for him. Like I said, that might have been just a regular pop fly in a normal game, but with that wind blowing out to left center like that,
it carried, and it was out of here. Here's now Drew Avens. Looked at the first pitch, liked what he saw. Couldn't get it out of the infield, out number one. Number two, Carson Kreitz heading to the plate now. Carson batting 295 on the season, almost 300. If he was batting at 300, he'd be the fourth Southeastern player on the roster to be batting 300.
Yeah, Southeastern lineup is full of consistent hitters. Taylor Schwinner, Carson Kreitz, Drew Avens, Derek Mount. This lineup is filled.
Kreitz last year was named to the All-Louisiana first team, batting 295 this year, hit 298 last year. at 13 doubles on the season, a triple, eight home runs this year. He's got four doubles and two triples, leading the team in triples, and that one home run you just talked about.
One thing about Tanner Driscoll, the pitcher, he's given up 26 hits this year, or 27 now, and now 16.
Bounces off the pole.
Now 16 runs. So it's not like he gives up many hits, but when he does, they're for runs.
Driscoll, now this is his fourth start of the season, with the team leading 24 and one-third innings. So the teams have seen more of Driscoll than anyone else so far in this young season. Here's Kreitz now with a full count. Three balls, two strikes, the one out, and the leadoff home run. Tie this game up at 1-1. Here's the delivery now. Call strike three.
Good location there by Driscoll. Outside corner, painted outside corner.
Kreitz didn't like what he saw, and now he's heading to the bench. Coming up to the plate now is number 15, Taylor Schwanner, and is he on a tear or what?
He's been hot lately. Five home runs the past seven games. Louisville Slugger, National Player of the Week. He's definitely on a hot streak, like you said.
And looked at the first pitch, drove it deep left. Another quick inning there for us. Southeastern tied it up. Heading to the second inning, it's Lamar 1, Southeastern 1. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field, and that'll get you standing up. A deep drive to left field, carried over the fence. A leadoff home run for Ryan Byers to tie this game at 1-1. But a quick paced game so far. That first inning just sort of flew by. And if you're just joining us, you just missed a Sonic hot dog and a slushy chase and terrorize a poor child around the bases. It was really a sight to see, Dylan.
It might have been a race, but I think the kid won. So
I think the kid won, too. I hope he gets some free Sonic out of that.
With a little help from the Lions baseball team slowing down the dog and the slushy.
That always helps. Now here's Squiller coming back to the mound. Gave up that one run in the first inning. Seward in center field sort of lost sight of it. It was a deep shot to center. Went over his head, like you said, probably carried by that wind. It is strong out there between 10 and 15 miles per hour. And at the plate now is Trey Silvers, number 44. Temple College transfer, batting 261 on the year. And Silvers so far this season, he was the projected starting first baseman. And it's taken a while for him to get back into the swing of things. And tonight he actually is starting at first. Coach Will Davis never lost confidence in Silvers. Just said it was going to take a while for him to get his legs under him.
And that's big for a player, is that if your coach believes in you, then you can believe in yourself. And that's how you get out of the slump. The coach believes in you, keeps giving you the reps, doesn't bench you. Definitely big for a confidence booster.
Last year, Silvers It's an extra base machine. Racked up 21 extra base hits. 32 overall hits in 65% of the time. He was hitting for multiple bases. He's got one ball, two strikes on him now. High and inside there. Relatively patient hitter, 10 walks on the season.
Whenever he's in the lineup, he's definitely good. He had, in 26 starts, he had 10 multi-hit games.
There's a shot. It's going to land for another hit deep in left field, a single. So far, Lamar finding success with their leadoff hitters.
That's key. That's definitely what Lamar wants to do. They want to get their leadoff men on base, drive them in, drive in those runs.
Solid shot to left field there. They're fighting a lot of success there. Here's number 21, Chad Fleshman. Chad on the season batting 182. He's a junior. Hasn't played in too many games. Just the fourth game he's played in this season. Excuse me, the seventh game he's played in this season. Just the fourth start. Here's Scroller now, one strike on the batter. The delivery, shot deep again. Trying to judge it correctly, and he does. Out number one here at the top of the second.
One thing Southeastern does not have to really worry about is the threat on the base pads for Lamar. Lamar has only attempted six stolen bases, even though they're 6-for-6 in the year, they've only stolen six. So a steal threat really shouldn't be the main focus for them right now. I think the focus for Stroller should just be on the batter.
That's a great point, Dylan. And on the other side, Southeastern is the most aggressive base running team in the entire conference. They've got 38 stolen bases on the season.
We talked to Reiser before the game, and he referenced back to the West Virginia game that the West Virginia pitcher actually tried to pick off the runner seven straight times. And every single time he did that, Coach Reiser would call a steal. Until finally the pitcher pitched to home, and they finally stole him. When they did, they got it. Always aggressive, small ball.
It's definitely something Reiser talked about. He said that, you know, most teams may not practice base running too much, but he used a football analogy saying, you know, special teams. We look at base running as special teams. Base running is our special teams, line down first base, foul ball there, but he talked about base running being their special team, something they worked on every single day in practice. And like you said in that instance there, something that can win you a game if you do it correctly. Here at the plate now is number 24, freshman phenom for Lamar. The other starting freshman, Peyton Robertson. Him and Cole Coker finding success in this young season for Lamar. So far these two, they both start in the infield. They've started a combined six games. In those six games, they've collected 12 hits and 44 plate appearances, batting .272 with nine runs scored and four RBIs. Scroller now again, another shot. Deep center, Seward trying to get under it, tries to find it, he does. Out number two.
Same scenario as last inning. Leadoff man gets on base and the next two batters get out, so we'll see if Lamar can make a two-out rally here with the man on first base.
Number one, center fielder, Grant DeVore.
Grant DeVore now a late entry in the lineup. DeVore is a junior. He's batting only .143 on the season. On his 12th start of the year. Another junior college transfer, and this Lamar lineup is filled with them.
Absolutely.
Outside of the freshman talent, a lot of players from all over the place. Will Davis did a good job of getting guys here. A shot, deep center. Seward's going to be under it, though, for out number three on the inning. Nothing going for Lamar there. No runs. Your score, Lamar 1, Southeastern 1. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel.
Be sure to check out the dugout concession stand for some great snacks like game sponsor, the Olive Garden, being a proud supporter of Lions Athletics. As baseball fans, Racing Canes believes in supporting the Lions with the same passion we have for serving our customers hot, fresh chicken finger meals. Because when it comes to Southeastern baseball, we go all out. Lion fans, make sure to check out the new and improved concession stands. Now accepting credit cards, courtesy of our sponsors at Processing Solutions.
Welcome back to Alumni Field. Here we are at the bottom of the second inning. I'm Wesley Boone alongside Dylan Domingue. Game tied up now. Lamar 1, Southeastern 1. Southeastern leadoff home run. Bottom of the first, tie the game up. Nothing going for Lamar at the top of the second. Up to bat now is Derek Mount. Definitely a dual threat athlete. He is a infielder and also a pitcher for this Lions squad.
He pitched Tuesday at South Alabama. Shut them out for a while.
He's having a good year pitching too. 2.84 ERA. He has two appearances this season. Actually one start. Giving up six hits. Only two earned runs. Four strikeouts. Does a little bit of everything. Also batting 302. So doing it all for this Southeastern Lions team and draws a leadoff walk.
Four pitches. Couldn't find the strike zone.
That happens sometimes. Up to the plate now is Jacob Seward, the 2015 Southland Conference Player of the Year, batting 284 on the season. He is a senior. And something about Seward that I find really interesting is last season in the entire nation, he was the second toughest batter to strike out. Extremely patient. You see the pick right there, trying to keep him honest at first base. But he averaged one strikeout every 26 at-bats. Struck out just 9 times. That's amazing.
Never give a pitcher an easy out, and Jacob Seward's one of the best at it.
So far this season, 10 strikeouts. Started every game for the Lions in some form or fashion, 19 hits on the season.
A note about Tanner Driscoll's leadoff walk. He does not give a free pass often. That's only his third walk of the year.
He makes you earn it. And Derek Mount definitely earned it there. So here's Seward now. He's a New Orleans native. Went to Brother Martin High School in New Orleans. And since he's joined this Southeastern Lions team, he's racked up the accolades. Lays down a bunt. It's going to be foul for strike number two. Trying to advance that runner from first to second. But Dylan, since joining the Lions in 2014, he has been a staple of this Southeastern program.
Agreed.
One of the most consistent players.
And I was about to just say that, very consistent. And that's what you need out of someone in your lineup. No matter where he is in the batting lineup, he's always consistent, will always put up similar numbers. And that's big, knowing that you can rely on him every time he goes up to bat.
There's a shot right in the gap. Past the outstretched arms of the first baseman. And there's Mount. He's going to make it all the way to third base. Seward advancing the runner. Runners on the corners now for Southeastern.
The reason that was so effective is because the pitch previous, Seward squared up for a bunt. So that drew the infield in. So the first baseman was playing close, and when he hit that little floater, it went right past the first baseman.
Right out of position. That is a great observation there, Dylan. And you saw the semi little quasi meeting between the catcher and the pitcher there, trying to square things up. Scotty Sanders now entering the batter's box for Southeastern. He's actually born in San Diego, California. Considered his hometown to be Thibodaux, Louisiana, though. Went to E.D. White High School.
5 minutes where I live.
There you go. A lot of former Major League Baseball players are these Southeastern players' fathers, and that's no exception here. His dad was a former first-round pick. Pitched for the Padres, Mariners, Tigers, and Cubs in a long career.
His father, Scott Sanders, went to Nicholls State University, which is the rival for Southeastern, so a little bit of family rivalry right there.
Must have been an interesting recruiting process for him.
The defense is in a double play alignment right now, so if a ball is hit up to short or second, they can try to turn a double play.
Trying to keep Seward honest on first base again. We talked about how aggressive this Southeastern team is at base running. Seward getting a healthy lead now. Gonna test Driscoll again.
Seward is 2-for-3 on the year for stolen bases, so easily a threat to steal.
Sanders now, 2 balls, 1 strike. No outs here at the bottom of the second inning. A beautiful evening for baseball here in Hammond, Louisiana. Here's the lineup and the pitch.
We even got fans in the car garage, in the parking garage over there, watching the game.
Got to be a great view, too.
Don't have to pay for a ticket. Just go drive to the very top and just watch the game from there.
There you go. 3 balls, 1 strike now on Sanders. Seward with a healthy lead, and Driscoll pushes him back.
Driscoll's having a hard time in this inning trying to find the strike zone.
He's definitely all over the place.
Walked Mountain 4 pitches, and that was on a 3-1 count.
And that's going to be ball 4. Loading the bases early is Driscoll, and that is going to warrant a timeout. His catcher wants to get his head cleared now, and we talked about Driscoll struggling early in this season. He had got out of the first after that leadoff home run rather innocently, but you see it now. This is a very tough situation to be in if you're a pitcher. Bases loaded, no outs. And that's why the infield's going to meet.
For Southeastern, they definitely have to take advantage of this opportunity. 0 outs, bases loaded. Definitely need to take the lead and add runs. And for Lamar, you're hoping for a grounder right up in the infield where you can throw it to home and throw it at first or get a double play and only give up 1 run.
Well, here you are now. You bring the Mr. Evan Pace to the plate. Evan is batting 143 on the season.
Evan
Just
Pace.
The singular RBI.
Evan Pace is the catcher, and he has exchanged times with Daniel Wassinger for the position this year. But I think you hit on it earlier. Evan Pace is currently on a 7-game on-base streak right
yes,
now.
Yes, 7 games in a row now he's got on base, and that started right around the time that he was actually put in the game. He's played 7 games.
I'm sure he would like to have the 8 right here.
Well, it would be big. He's only has that 1 RBI on the season. He only wants to boost the numbers in that column up. Driscoll now in a tight situation. 1 ball on the batter, bases loaded, no outs. Here's the delivery. And there's a strike.
Strike call in the outside corner. Great off-speed pitch there.
Evan Pace, the sophomore. Shot right up the middle. It's going to be right out of the reach of the shortstop. 2 runs will score. Weiser's not too happy about that. Good throw from center field.
Definitely a close play
third base.
From our point of view. But like you said, great vision and great throw, great arm there by Lamar, center fielder.
Evan Pace standing on second base now after driving in 2 runs. Maybe 1 out, but that brings the score now to 3-1. Pace coming up clutch.
Taking advantage of the opportunity.
3 RBIs on the season now.
He doubled what he had all year in 1 hit.
Comes with extended playing time.
And I also want to add, Evan Pace, great vision there, seeing the throw go to third, advancing to second.
Exactly.
Doesn't stay
he
at first.
Hesitated after he got at, after he rounded first base, watched the throw, and on the throw headed to second base. Great observation. Here's Brennan Bro now, number 13, sophomore from Norco, Louisiana, went to Destrehan High School, batting 158 on the season. He was a 2016 Louisville Slugger freshman All-American and the 2016 Southland Conference Freshman of the Year.
If you don't recognize his number, he was number one last year. I have heard from sources that he changed his number to 13 because he has had a friend who was number 13, I think back at Estrahan, and he got in a bad car accident and was actually not able to play baseball again. So he wears number 13 in honor of him.
Wow.
So great story.
That is a great story. Solemn foul one off right there. Brings up the count now. One ball, one strike, one out. With Pace with a healthy lead on second base. Driscoll eyeing him down. Here's the pitch outside corner.
Close call there. You see Brennan Bro, he's hitting 170 on the year. Definitely maybe a sophomore slump for batting, but fielding has gotten so much better. Last year he struggled. He made a good bit of errors, but he has definitely worked in the offseason with the team and with the coaches to make sure.
Most definitely, and Bro with 45 assists in the young season, sort of speaking to what you just said, he's gotten a lot better in the field. Not as many errors. Much better fielding percentage, and a drive now deep to right. Runner's going to stay at second. Can bring us now to the top of the lineup.
I know that was a tough play to read, but I think Southeastern would have liked to try to advance the runner there from second to third with the ball being hit in right field. But it was a line drive hit, so I can kind of see.
Yeah,
why he
couldn't
was not
exactly
able to advance.
Tell if it was going to fall or not, especially with this wind. Now, back up to bat is Ryan Byers, who hit that leadoff home run, trying to conjure up some of that same magic he had at the top of the first inning.
We'll see if Southeast is going to make a two-out rally here with a runner on second base, or if Driscoll and Lamar can get out this inning, only giving up two runs with the bases loaded.
Byers definitely very durable. He started games last season at all three outfield positions. He can do a little bit of everything, like a lot of guys for this Southeastern team. They work him everywhere.
Always good when you can move him around.
He's from Covington, another local product. Marketing major here at Southeastern. Senior. Shot right to the shortstop, picks it up, tossed to first. And that's going to be the third out. Southeastern, though, managed to score two runs with the bases loaded, bringing the score. Lamar 1, Southeastern 3. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. Here's Evan Pace driving one right up the middle. Two runs would score, and that would extend Southeastern's lead 3-1. Controversial call, at least for Coach Reiser there at third base. Now we're back at the top of the lineup for Lamar. 36, Cutter McDowell, who had a leadoff double to start the game. Fifth on the team last season in RBIs, 28. And he batted, see it there, tip strike.
Swinging for the fences, that's what that was. That was a power swing.
But he was a leadoff hitter most of last season, which speaks volumes if you've got that many RBIs as a leadoff hitter. Driving in runs from the bottom of the lineup. That means strike there.
That means the players at the bottom of the lineup are getting on base.
Which is exactly what you want.
Consistent throughout the whole lineup, not top heavy.
Here's McDowell now. Schooler missing the outside. To talk about this Lamar team, we've talked about the transfers, we've talked about the young players on this team. All of that can be attributed to Coach Will Davis, who knows a thing or two about South Louisiana baseball, working for LSU through LSU's really glory days, their glory run over the course of the past decade or so, an integral part in LSU's success as an assistant coach. Fouled one off there, got a full count, 3-2.
You said it, he worked on the staff for LSU, and you know, he was there when LSU won the World Series. He's been a part of 4 World Series teams, actually. 3 in for the SEC. And 5 SEC championship teams. And he advanced in NCAA regionals every year but one while he was on staff there.
Shot to first base. Schooler coming in. Cleaning things up for the first out of the inning. But Davis, this is a young program, at least when it comes to having success here at Lamar. And you see what they were able to accomplish last year. They had a 15-game win streak. They actually beat LSU, including Arizona and Texas. That must have been an interesting homecoming for Coach Davis. And also ending up as the 4th seed in the Southland Conference Tournament, their highest seed since 2009. Coach Reiser's young. Coach Davis is also young. There's a shot now. Deep center, Seward sprinting forward. He's going to catch it for out number 2. But Davis is also young, only 32 years old. These are two young head coaches.
I think you're going to start seeing this more from more teams. I think you're going to see more coaches that are younger. They connect with the players.
Exactly.
Better.
You touched on this in pregame. You know, whenever Reiser was given the job, for example, he wasn't too far off from playing. And he kind of knows what it's like, that experience as a player. He's not 50, 60, 70, 30 years removed from his playing days. He can relate more to the players. And
he,
that was a great point.
He didn't just play for just a regular team. He played for Tulane.
Yeah.
And Tulane's consistently a dominant program. So he definitely knows a thing or two about baseball.
He was a integral part of that Tulane team in 2005, helping them make the regional finals and eventually the College World Series. Here's Reed now. Foul tip there.
Didn't want to swing at that one, but ball catches the very top of the bat. It's always a tough one.
Checked it down there. Powerful hitter is Reed Russell. Debatably the best power hitter in the conference. He sneaks that one over the first baseman. That's going to be a single. Thought he might stretch it in for 2, but he doesn't.
That was actually a really good play by Ryan Byers to hurry up and scoop up the ball and make it look like he's about to throw to second base to keep Russell on first base.
Great point there. Russell with the single. Again, he hits for power, but he also has the second best batting average on the Cardinals squad.
Outside pitch, and Russell swings a little late, and it was hit right off the end of the bat, and that's why it dropped in right down the third baseline. Right field line.
That's exactly where you take that outside pitch, too. Here's DH number 33, Robin Adams. Highest batting average on the team. The first Cardinal to be named Louisville Slugger Freshman All-American since the 09 season, and he popped out there for the third out of the inning. Nothing going for Lamar there. Your score, Lamar 1, Southeastern 3. You're watching Lion Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone alongside Dylan Domay. Early in this ball game now, it's the bottom of the third inning. Southeastern leads 3, Lamar's 1. Drew Avens now, liner to the first baseman. Tries to run it out, but Driscoll takes it in for the first out of the inning.
We talked about Darren Mountain being a dual threat, but Drew Avens is also a dual threat. He can pitch. He was very crucial for Southeastern in the win against West Virginia. Came in extra innings for 2 innings and shut down West Virginia. So he can do it at the plate, and he can do it on the mound as well.
A lot of guys on this Southeastern team, essentially Swiss Army knives, doing a little bit of everything here and there, playing a lot of different positions, contributing in a lot of different ways. Here's number 2, Carson Kreitz now. He's 0 for 1 of the game, batting 290 on the season. Fouled one off there. Down early in the count now. No balls, 2 strikes. From Amarillo, Texas, out of Amarillo High School. Texas product. 2016 All-Louisiana first-team player. 15 RBIs on the season, as you see.
I like that pitch by Driscoll. 0-2 count, throws a curveball on the outside corner just to see if he'll bite and swing.
Trying to get him to chase something, like you said. Chases that one. Hits it right to the third baseman for out number 2. Coming up to bat now is number 15, Taylor Schwanner. And he is leading some major statistical categories here in the Southland Conference. He's actually first in RBIs in the conference with 24, tied for second in home runs with 4, with none other than Reed Russell in the other dugout.
Baseball certainly runs in his blood, and he's following his family's footsteps. His brother played for UNO, drafted twice. He used to play for the Rays minor league team. His uncle was the coach for UNO from 1986 to 1999, and his dad was on the 1984 World Series team for UNO. So family went to UNO, but he decided to come here to Southeastern.
Lucky for us. Also has 8 stolen bases on the season, but won't get an opportunity there. Couldn't get on base. Strikes out. 3 up, 3 down for Lamar. Your score, Southeastern 3, Lamar 1. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone alongside Dylan Domang. Robert Adams is in the batter's box, number 33. He's trying to continue a 26-game on-base streak. And he's the only Cardinal to be on base in every single game this season. His on-base percentage is second best on the team, only behind Reed Russell. It's .476. He has an on-base percentage of .450. Adams now the sophomore out of Bronx, New York.
The Bronx.
The Bronx. How'd he end up down here?
Don't hear too many kids from out there come down here to play.
You definitely don't. Maybe he got sick of the cold. Two balls, one strike now on Adams. Fouls one deep, but it's going to go out of bounds. Excuse me, out of play. Nice crowd here on this Friday night. A beautiful night for baseball.
I call the crowd the Southeastern Sound.
I know that's lame. That's interesting.
That's lame, probably like the Seattle Sound. But one interesting note about the crowd, I've heard there is a fan who is not allowed to sit in the area behind home plate because of how loud she is. She actually has to sit on the third or first base line.
Wow. A little too passionate, huh?
Yeah.
Hey, rather too much passion than not enough. You see Adams there, foul one down third base line. His count now, two balls, two strikes. Definitely some passionate baseball fans here in Hammond, Louisiana. As we've said, the past two seasons, Southeastern has ranked number one in attendance for their games. Doesn't help to have a good product on the field either. Here's the windup and the release. Full count now, the batter, three balls, two strikes. Scroller having a good game so far outside of the one earned run.
Set her down after that first inning. Close call in the outside corner.
And there's the Southeastern Sound, letting it be known they weren't too happy with that particular call.
We're going to make that stick, the Southeastern Sound. We're
exactly.
Gonna have, like, posters.
Even if it's not any good, we'll just keep saying it until people subliminally just refer to it.
So people just get aggravated.
Exactly.
Calling the Southeastern
They'll
Sound.
Hate us. Here's number 44, Trey Silvers now. Junior college transfer, batting .260. 61 on the season. Shot deep, going to test Seward. Seward running up, makes the play for out number one here at the top of the fourth inning.
One of the best center fielders in the entire country, actually, is Jacob Seward. Despite from that first batter where the ball went over his head, he's always consistent.
Scroller here is not having to work too hard so far in this game. A lot of one-pitch outs. Lamar falling in love with that first pitch. Not a very high pitch count early in this game. Scroller, since his first outing of the season against Hofstra, has steadily increased his innings per game. That's as usual, too. You're coming out of the offseason. You got to work your way back into things. And pitched 8 innings against UNO over a week ago. Deep foul, out of play. Hopefully no one's driving along the street.
I was just thinking about that. And they always play the sound.
Of glass breaking.
Yeah.
And it's so funny until it happens to you, I'm telling you.
The first time I heard it, I thought something broke. That's why I like to park my truck far away.
Really far.
Never be too careful.
Never can be too careful.
Great.
Hold strike three for out number two.
And that's what I was talking about. The batter looked like he was thinking fastball there, and Mac threw a curveball, and it buckled. The batter buckled his knees, and he was not ready for it.
Scroller finding his groove in this game. Like you said, restless early, but definitely calmed down as number 24, Peyton Robinson, heads to the plate now.
Almost
high and inside.
Almost hit him.
That'll back you off the plate. Robertson, part of that freshman dynamic duo we've talked about several times so far in this game. Him and Coker hoping to start as freshman and keep it that way for the next 3 years. Having a good season so far as Peyton Robertson batting 250. His ninth start of the season came in this game. Doing well in the field, 23 assists. All around solid so far. There's strike number one.
You'll see Lamar swing on their first pitch, and they'll swing at a lot of pitches because of their aggressiveness. That's right,
that
above
was
us, actually.
Up there next to Saturn. Let's see where it comes down, and it comes down out of play. Surprised it didn't get caught up there in the atmosphere. Might be covered in ice.
It's always scary. You can never really read where that ball is going to go until it's like right there.
Never quite know. Peyton Robertson's father actually played professional baseball. He played for the Phillies, and his uncle, Andre, played for the Yankees. So professional baseball blood in his family. Count now, 2 balls, 2 strikes. Scroller taking the signal. Here comes the delivery and the pitch. Low and inside for ball number 3. Runner on first now, 2 outs. Full count on number 24, Peyton Robertson.
You're going to see a steal right here from the first base from the runner at first on this pitch.
Great play, good throw, and out number 3. Nothing going for Lamar there. Your score, Lamar 1, Southeastern 3. You're watching Southeastern Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone alongside Dylan Domingue. Count now 1 ball, 1 strike on Derek Mount.
Get off speed pitch there from Driscoll.
We've seen some good from Driscoll so far in this game, trying to get his feet under him after a rough go of things here early in the 2017 season. A solid shot, deep to left center. Center fielder makes a good play for out number 1.
Wynn couldn't help that ball get out.
Nope, wasn't quite enough to carry that one out of here. Speaking of center fielders, here's center fielder number 3, Jacob Seward, up to bat. Shot right in the gap to the right fielder. It's going to be a single.
Found the hole between the first and second baseman and hit it right there between them.
Solid shot there. Opportunity for Sanders to make some noise now. Runner on first base, Sanders, a big man, 6'3", 218. One of the bigger players on this Southeastern roster.
When you talk to him, he has the biggest country accent you've ever heard.
From Thibodaux, Louisiana. Seward, healthy lead on first base there. Sanders, 182 on the season, one home run, three RBIs.
Ball.
And not something you see every day.
Coach looks like he wants to get an explanation on that.
Davis exactly not quite sure why the ball call, so he's going to jog out on the field and have a quick word with the umpire.
Either way, the runner wanted to get the second. He was stealing, and he went to throw it to first. He got back in time, but it was a ball, so he's at second.
Runner in scoring position now for Scotty Sanders. Will Davis not too happy as he makes his slow.
Balls are always one of the hardest calls. It's not something, like you said, it happens every day. Not something you see all the time. But it's just one of those mistakes where you take your foot off the rubber when you're not supposed to, or you're not set for a whole second. Just different things.
It can come back to bite you. Seward on second now. Here's Sanders. One ball, one strike now on the batter. Southeastern trying to capitalize with the runner in scoring position. Driscoll trying to calm down after the balk that sends Seward to second base. Driscoll looking back. Saw Seward trying to avoid that ball, hit hard to the shortstop. Sanders advances Seward, though, to third base. Two outs now with the runner in scoring position.
Evan Pace. Evan Pace looking to get his third RBI in the game.
In this position in the second inning and drove in two runs. Has now hit safely or got on base safely in eight straight games. Cold strike there. One ball, one strike now, two outs.
That was a good slider by Driscoll right there, painted on the outside corner.
Got a piece of that one. Fouled it out of play.
Driscoll reminds me of Tim Lincecum with his hair. Well, the old Tim Lincecum.
I wonder if he can eat as many cheeseburgers. Because that was a big thing with Lincecum, was that guy's appetite was crazy.
And that's a small guy, too.
I know. He's not someone who you could assume could eat four In-N-Out burgers, but don't want to know his cholesterol.
That was a weird call. It looked like the catcher or the batter had called time, so the pitcher stopped his pitching motion, and he's called ball for the second time this inning.
Now, here's something interesting about that, though, is even though the batter calls timeout, the umpire has to grant the player timeout. The umpire does not grant the player timeout. It is a live ball. And I think that's what you saw in that situation there. You saw the player maybe ask for a timeout, and the umpire didn't grant it.
The umpires are going to meet up and talk about this. But, yeah, it looked like the pitcher had started his motion before the timeout was called. And the batter looks like
they're
going to
send it back, and that's going to be on the umpire in that situation. It falls flatly on his shoulders. It's a situation where the pitcher, it's a safety concern at that point. If the batter asks for a timeout, the pitcher's obviously going to oblige if he sees it happen early enough.
I know the Southeastern Sound and the Southeastern Lions are not going to be happy with this, getting the runner back at third, but I think that was very good for the umpires to get together, discuss what happened, and to make the right call.
And I think that's what they discussed in their huddle was, you know, I probably should have granted him timeout, and I didn't quite do it. Two balls, two strikes now. Takes a run off the board.
Driscoll wanted strike three there. He was walking off the mound, walking to the dugout.
just off the outside corner for ball three. Two outs now, three balls, two strikes on Evan Pace. Runner on third base, that's Seward. Here's the windup and the pitch for ball four. Another timeout on the field. And this might be the end of Driscoll, and I think it is. Driscoll having a rough go of it here early in the 2017 season.
Definitely a short outing for Driscoll, not what he had planned.
Couldn't even get through four innings, and as they change pitchers, we'll take a break. You're watching Southeastern Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. Some chaos here at the bottom of the fourth inning. A balk called and then another balk called and overturned by the umpires after meeting up and discussing it. Entering the game now to pitch is Ryan Johnson. He has only seen one inning of work in this young season. He's a left-handed pitcher. He is a transfer, a junior from Beaumont, Texas. Transfer from East Oklahoma State. His one inning of work this year came against Rice. Gave up one hit, no runs, no earned runs. Gonna get a chance to show what he's got here against one of the best teams in the conference. And his warm-up pitches, he's nice and warm now.
You know, this is a crazy note, crazy topic. I'm just looking at the advertisement and outfield wall. And even if Lamar's not here, they're always here. We got an advertisement. It's not same Lamar, it's not the university, but in center field there is a Lamar.
Always represented as Lamar. You just can't get away from him. Chasing you everywhere you go. Here's Ryan Johnson now. A steal, and he's going to be there easily.
It looked like Lamar was playing the matchup here. Lefty on lefty with two outs. Definitely a good move by Lamar.
Let's Sanders on out. Second now, bro in the batter's box. Yet another steal for this conference leading squad in Southeastern. 39 steals on the season now. Cold strike there on Brennan Bro. The sophomore infielder. Only batting 155 on the season, only four RBIs. You see the three stolen bases.
That was Scotty Sanders' first stolen base of the year. I mean, uncontested. I mean, there was no throw. That's his first of the year.
So you don't think he earned it? Is that what you're saying?
Oh, he earned it. He ran full speed.
I'm just joking with you. Got Bro, the 2016 Southland Conference Freshman of the Year. We talked about the sophomore slump he seems to be going through so far. Only batting 155 on the season. We talked about how much better he's got in the field, though. Responsible for 45 assists.
I'm sorry, I was wrong. That is not Scotty Sanders at second base. That is Evan Pace. That is my bad. But that is still Evan Pace's first stolen base of the year on his first attempt.
They're going to send Bro to first base. Bases loaded, two outs. Not the first time we've had this situation in this game. Another timeout. Like you said, they were just playing the situation, couldn't get the out, so.
They're going to bring in the righty.
Going to see another pitching change here, and as they change pitchers, we'll take a break. You're watching Lions baseball here on the Southeastern Channel.
Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone. Joined alongside me here is Dylan Domang. It's a beautiful night for collegiate baseball here in Hammond, Louisiana, where the Southeastern Lions are ahead of the Lamar Cardianls 3-1. We had a pitching change this last inning. Ryan Coffin entered the game for Lamar. Dylan, you spoke to Lamar sort of playing the situation whenever they entered Ryan Johnson in the game.
Yeah, a right-handed sidearm pitcher. That's one of the hardest things for a right-hand batter to see is a sidearm. Because when that ball is released, it's released looking like it's going to hit you if you're the batter. That ball is going to sink right in over the plate. So it definitely messes with the hitter's eye. So Ryan Byers is definitely going to have to stay on top of the ball here.
Great analysis there. Ryan Byers. Home run, leadoff home run to start things off for the Lions in the first inning. He's got two balls, one strike on him now. Batting .229 for the season, two home runs, 11 RBIs, one stolen base. Solid campaign so far, time on the field.
This is the second time tonight that the Southeastern Lions have the bases loaded.
With two outs nonetheless. Byers with an opportunity to make some noise. We talked about how difficult it is for a right-handed batter to really digest and process the ball coming from that release point. This counts 3-1 now. Strike two. Three balls, two strikes on the batter.
Crazy pitching motion and crazy hair, and we got another 10 minutes to come on the mound.
Big pitch right here. A drive that might land. And it does not. Great play by the right fielder for the third out of the inning. That brings your score, Southeastern 3, Lamar 1. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel.
Scroller, you see it there on the strikeout. Nasty curveball. He's having a great game tonight. Welcome back to Alumni Field. It's been an entertaining game so far. Max Scroller having a very good performance so far in this game. Just a one earned run.
Definitely up that first inning, he set her down. Hasn't allowed a runner to score since.
Cold strike, strike one.
Key factor for him is that he's been able to mix his pitches up. Like we said, in, you know, during the game and pregame, he has four good pitches.
Popped one up, not gonna stay in play. Whoa.
May have actually
broken a window that time. Hopefully they've got some good insurance. They didn't actually even need the broken glass sound effect here.
That
was the real sound. Grant DeVore breaking windows here in Hammond, Louisiana. And intent on breaking some more with another foul ball there. 12th start of the year for Grant DeVore. Junior college transfer. Junior college academic All-American.
Oh, hit him on top
and
of the head.
He took a solid shot. And he's down. He's going to get up and shake it off, though.
He's going to get right away, but a trainer's going to have to talk to him just to see if any kind of concussion, side effects, or...
You've definitely seen an awareness in the sport of baseball when it comes to concussions over the course of the past 4 or 5 years. I think that's sparked sort of by the same conversations being happened in football, but you see the advances in technology for helmets and facial protection and the caution they now take with players who have been hit high.
I know, a scary moment. I know people say that baseball isn't a contact sport, but those people probably haven't taken a 80 to 90 miles an hour pitch off the head or
close to the shoulder. We see it here. Grant DeVore in the batter's box. Scroller dealing. And you see it, a scary moment coming in.
Ooh,
high
it
inside.
It might have hit him actually on the neck area.
It's quite possible that it did. You see him collapse to the ground. The umpire immediately come out of the field.
It looks like he's going to stay in the game. Looks like the trainer cleared him, but
cautioning the pitcher.
Definitely a good thing to see is that he's okay.
Happy to see DeVore up.
I played baseball for 8 years, and I've taken a few pitches off the body, and I tell you what, anywhere, they don't feel good. So I know off the head, neck area, he'll feel that in the morning.
Well, as the coach used to say, that's why we wear helmets.
Put some dirt on it.
Rub some dirt on it. On your concussion. Foul that one. Out of play there. DeVore on first base.
Broken glass everywhere.
Real and fake. Scroller now. Taking the signal. Here's the windup. Out of play again. Back to the top of the lineup now. Cutter McDowell having a solid season for the Lamar Cardianls. He's a senior, 6'3", 205, out of Galveston Junior College. One of the many transfers on this squad. No balls, two strikes, Scroller heading the count. Top of the fifth inning now. Runner on first, DeVore.
Southeastern Sound is not liking the sound of that call there, called ball.
Home plate umpire having a rough go of things so far.
This is my lame attempt for a joke, ready? Cutter McDowell was a pitcher, his best pitch would be the cutter.
Wow, that was lame. I'm joking. That wasn't too bad. Also, speaking of cutter, one thing they don't need on this field anymore is a lawnmower, since they've gone to the artificial turf, and boy, is it nice. We talked to Coach Rice before the game about how much better it is to play on this turf. It's easier to judge the ball. It's easier to sort of understand the hops. And he really was a strong supporter of playing on artificial turf. As you see Scroller here, he's kind of in wild this half inning, and Pace going out there to calm him down.
But you hit on it. Most of the fielders actually like the artificial turf, but one position that actually doesn't is the pitcher. Because when you have a dirt mound, your foot finds a hole. It'll create a hole. And on that artificial turf, it never will. So it's always, it's a little bit more uncomfortable. Some pitchers can adjust to it, some pitchers can't.
A steal. Not something you see very often from this Lamar Cardinals squad.
Seven for seven,
there you go.
Perfect.
And I think that might be Coach Will Davis acknowledging that, hey, we need to get aggressive in this game. If we want to stay in this game, we need to be aggressive. We need to take our chances where we can get them, because this Southeastern squad, they've had several opportunities to blow this game open, and it just hasn't quite happened. You saw it last inning. Bases loaded, two outs, couldn't get anything going. But Lamar needs base runners, and they need to put some runners in scoring position, and they have it now.
At the top of the lineup, definitely good to have a runner in scoring position.
Freshman Cole Coker now.
Looks like possibly the coach having missed signals with the catcher, not being on the same page, having discussions with him. Looks like that might be what it be, but not exactly sure.
Whatever it is, Reiser coming out to speak to Pace. Coker now. Freshman from Huffman Hargrave High School, nicknamed Coco. If it gets much chillier tonight, we might need some hot cocoa.
I wonder if he likes Cocoa Krispies.
Probably his favorite cereal.
We'll have to ask him if he becomes a broadcaster.
Set up in the box and we can all talk about our favorite cereals. Batting 302 on the season, leading. Excuse me, top three, tip strike right there. One of the leaders in batting average for this squad. 12th start of the season came today. Perfect in the field, 30 assists, no errors. We're going to head down to Richie Solaris. Richie, how are things down there? Trying to find Mr. Solaris. Might be scarfing down a hot dog. Can't blame him.
Me and Richard were taking batting practice actually before the game, so he might have actually been recruited to be joining the team.
Might be out there in the bullpen.
Richie has some good opposite field power. I'll admit that. he hit a ball to right field off of me, so I wasn't too happy it was off of me, but impressed always by...
You gave him his props.
Impressed by always our fellow announcers.
Coker now, three balls, one strike. Scroller having a wild top of the fifth inning here.
Southeastern got, can't exactly tell, but they have someone warming up in the bullpen right now.
Ball four. So Scroller now... Runners on first and second, and his teammates want to come and give him an encouraging word. There is action in the bullpen. That is number 29 for Southeastern. Getting warmed up. Carlisle Koestler. Extended meeting here on the mound.
Looks like he's going to stick with Mac and not go to the bullpen right now, see if Mac can get out of this inning.
If Mac doesn't make it out of this inning, it'll be tied for his shortest start of the season. His first start against Hofstra, making it through five innings. Runners on first and second for Lamar now. A huge opportunity to change the tides in this ball game. Here's Scroller now, wind up in the delivery. Strike one. Lamar started off the top of the first inning with the leadoff double. Eventually brought that man in from second to take an early lead before Southeastern tied it with a leadoff home run. And then the second inning, Evan Pace drives in two with a double. That brought our score to Southeastern 3, Lamar 1. But Lamar threatening now here at the top of the fifth inning.
Very good bit of base runner so far, but both teams only have four hits so far through this game.
And this is not the guy you want to see with runners in scoring position. Opposite field power is Reed Russell, making it hard for the right fielder to make a play. Runner from second tags up. That's Grant DeVore. He's going to be moved to third base now. Russell, sacrifice pop-up.
That drove Byers out almost to the warning track. And what's a key note to have is since the game started, the wind has died down a lot.
It definitely has. You can see those flags dead in center field, where at the beginning of the game they were roaring, almost flying off of their poles. Pace giving signals to his infield. Robin Adams, number 33, highest batting average on the team, has seen the bases in every single game this season, a streak that was actually extended from last season, the only player on this roster to do so. Opportunity to drive in a run for Lamar here, runner on third base. Grant DeVore looking a lot better since getting struck in the head at the beginning of this inning. Swing and a miss for strike two.
Big fastball there from Swoller.
And Adams wanted it. Powerful swing. We'll head down to Richie Solaris. Richie. Can't seem to find him, still missing. Probably locked in the bathroom. One ball, two strikes now on Robin Adams as we try to find Richie Solaris.
Did you know the bathroom is actually located behind, or it's basically located in the same building as the opponent's team dugout?
Wow.
Yeah. I went to a game last year.
Trying to incorporate that, maybe that foul smell into the dugout, you know, trying to get in the head of the opponent.
All part of the home field advantage.
There you go.
I went to a game last year, and we were kind of lined up outside the bathroom. And there was a player from the opposing team who tried to get in the bathroom, and we made him wait.
Whenever you come to Alumni Field, you've got to deal with the fans, and you have to deal with long lines.
The Southeastern sound.
Exactly. A variety of sounds here in Hammond, Louisiana. Crucial situation for Lamar now. One ball, two strikes on Adams. High, trying to get him to chase it there.
We've seen the runner at first a few pitches ago actually try to steal second on a foul ball. He hasn't attempted it since. Surprised.
Very surprising indeed.
The second baseman and shortstop are playing basically in the outfield, and there
Scroller
he goes.
Scroller now. Nobody there. Runners on second and third. Two outs. A full count on the powerful hitter, Robin Adams, leading this Lamar Cardinals team in batting average. 25 hits on the season. Solid all-around player with a chance to drive in some runs, tie this ball game up. Here's Scroller now trying to get out of the fifth inning. The windup and the pitch. Low inside. Ball four now, bases loaded. Go-ahead run now coming up to the plate. It's none other than Trey Silvers.
Silvers is going for the gold here, seeing if he can drive these runs in.
I really hope they find Richie, though. I mean, he's missing a great game. It's kind of like a where in the world is Carmen Sandiego situation, Where in Hammond, Louisiana is Richie Solaris?
Scott Van Pelt on SportsCenter has a segment, is Where in the World Isn't Scott Van Pelt? And fans send in pictures on Twitter or any kind of social media on different bald guys with glasses.
That look like him?
Yeah.
That is a great segment.
Maybe Richie's going out retrieving all these foul balls.
Maybe so. Maybe he got roped into being the ball boy.
That's a lot of them.
I know. They've been flying around. I've explained to a lot of people about a lot of broken windows. Bases loaded now for Lamar. A chance to possibly tie it up or go ahead. Go ahead run at the plate now. One ball, one strike, two outs. Top of the fifth inning. Scroller struggling. Just trying to find a way to battle through and get this third out. A shot. Can't quite make the play. They're going to say his foot stayed on the base for the third out.
Wow. What a reach there.
And that might be something that I don't see anyone coming out to say anything about it.
That is the play of the game so far.
Most definitely, you had at least one run coming in, a second one rounding third base. Possibly a two-run swing there. Great inning there. Fantastic baseball. You're watching Southeastern Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. The game, quite possibly the play of the game so far, a fantastic play at first base by the first baseman, a nice stretch to get that third out, and defense helped Scroller get out of the jam there. Bottom of the fifth now, Drew Avens up at the plate. Batting 322 on the season, 0-2 tonight, as you see.
Shows bunt, pulls back and takes the ball.
Trying to get in the pitcher's head there. Seemed to have worked.
The third baseman is playing in.
Outside pitch. Couldn't quite get the call. Going to be a ball. Brings the count to 3-1. Drew Avens, his hometown is Alabaster, Alabama, out of Thompson High School. A junior. That's a shot. It's going to land for a single deep in left field. Avens rounding first, settling in. Nice way to start the inning for Southeastern.
Good opposite field power there. Leadoff man aboard for Southeastern.
Carson Kreitz, number two, coming up to the plate now. Amarillo, Texas product, and Amarillo High School.
Number two, Carson Wright.
Only the fifth hit of the game for Southeastern, too.
Started off hot in the first two innings. Things have definitely cooled down since then.
I feel like that's Louisiana weather, though. 2 hours, it'll be scorching hot, and the rest of the day will be a freezing cold.
There you go.
You can experience all four seasons in Louisiana in one day.
For sure. Carson Kreitz, 2016 All-Louisiana first-team player, hitting 286 on the season after going 0-for-2 tonight. Enter the game batting 295. Last year, compiled a 389 on-base percentage with 28 walks, 5 hit-by-pitches. Very patient at the plate. Likes to work pitchers, deep into the count. One ball, one strike now on Kreitz. Avens at first, makes it back in time.
Avens is a throw on the base pad. He's 5-for-7 on the year. And Drew Avens, oh, and Carson Kreitz, who's at the plate, is 4-for-4 on the year. Always a threat on the base pads.
Definitely the best team in the Southland when it comes to stealing bases.
In high school, Carson Kreitz ran track, so it definitely helps with that.
Doesn't hurt. Doesn't hurt to have.
And Coach Reiser talked about that. He said the players like running on the turf way better than the dirt because you never know if it rains, the dirt gets soggy, or in April when it's scorching hot and the dirt gets tough. This stays consistent, and the players definitely like this way better.
3-1 for the ever-so-patient Carson Kreitz. Bottom of the fifth inning now. We've had a good game so far. Southeastern debated going to their bullpen at the top of the inning. Squirrel got out of it thanks to a phenomenal defensive play, and that's going to be 4 on Kreitz. Runners move now from first to second. And runner on first. Kreitz with his 11th walk of this season. Speaking to that patience.
Where's your receiver for this?
Number 15, Taylor Schwanner coming to the plate. It's very hot entering the game. Cooled down 0-for-2 so far. Hitting 362, slugging 741. Runners on first and second. Schwanner trying to make something of it, extending this Southeastern lead. Outside of baseball, Schwanner is a huge golfer. Finds time to golf here. There's some beautiful courses here in the Hammond area. Lays down the bunt. Not something you see too often from Schwanner, but Reiser always can keep you guessing.
Back in high school, Taylor Schwanner played in the Connie Mack World Series, which took place in Farmington, New Mexico, which is a lot of national talent high school players go and play there. Definitely good for Schwanner.
His team captain in high school, all-district player playing in the Catholic League. He hit 350, pair home runs, 30 RBIs as a senior. Proving to be valuable at every level of ball that he's played. Initially born in Slidell, Louisiana. Grew up in New Orleans. Went to Holy Cross High School. Here's Schwanner now. 2 strikes. Runners take off. Schwanner fouls it off.
And something that this is the first time that Southeastern has done this today. It was a hit and run. Both runners steal and the batter swings.
We're going to head down to Richie Solaris. Richie, we've been looking for you, man. How are you?
Well, Wes, after that rough inning by pitcher Matt Skretler, the Lions are going to be going with a pitching change. They're going to be going with Carlisle Kessler. Coach Reiser said at Carlisle, they just want a fresh arm in there. Mac did a good job out there, but after hitting that pitcher, he knew that his arm was hurting, so they're going to bring in a fresh arm.
I didn't know they had a Mac Skretler.
I'm sure he's all over the place.
Oh yeah.
Thank you for that. Richie. We saw Carlisle warming up, and you see it there, sneaking in the gap. That's going to drive in a run.
Driving.
And Schwanner makes it work.
Schwanner keeps his hot streak alive with another RBI.
27th RBI on the season. That's leading the conference. Beautiful placement on that ball. Just put it right in the gap. But as Richie was saying, we saw Scroller struggle in that fifth inning. And as Richie pointed out to, Coach realized that, hey, if I can get him through this, we're going to get him out of there. Five innings matches his season low when it comes to innings pitched. And hit by pitch there is Derek Mount. Advancing runners now. Bases loaded.
I'm sure Reiser and Swoller would actually have liked for him to go further in the game. But you still got to be happy with what he did. Five innings, only one on run, four hits. Did struggle the last inning like we pointed out. But what he did, besides from that first inning, definitely was a good start for him.
Lamar is going to take a time out here, and they're going to make a pitching change. We'll take a break. We'll be right back with more Southeastern Baseball. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field, Southeastern there. Taylor Schwanner sneaking one right in the gap, driving in a run, extending this lead to 3 now. Southeastern 4, Lamar 1. We took a break as Lamar changed pitchers.
Number 3, center fielder.
Entering the game for Lamar, number 31, Brett Brown. Brett Brown on the season, he's pitched tied for the most relief innings out of any of their players. 3 innings pitched, 4 strikeouts, 4 earned runs. 12 strikeouts. Oh, that's going to be another run there.
Great base running there by Southeastern on all parts.
And as Coach Reiser called it, the special teams are paying off for Southeastern. Sacrifice hit, drives and a run. Six to one now. Holla, 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 holla.
So Brett Brown has seen 12 innings of work this year, allowed 11 hits, 4 earned runs, walked 9, struck out 12, an earned run average of 2.92.
The trainer right now is talking to the runner at third base. Maybe it looked like when he slid, he might have had some discomfort, maybe in his back or in his leg. So the trainer right now is looking at him and seeing.
It's Derek Mount over there on third base. Southeastern opening things up here at the bottom of the fifth inning.
The trainer and Mount are still talking, and it looks like Mountain will stay in the game.
Jacob Seward with the sacrifice hit.
Wait, actually, Mount will be coming out the game.
He is. He's checking out.
The pinch runner will be number 24, senior Webb Bobo, one of the best names in baseball.
A lot of good baseball names out on the field tonight. Webb Bobo has got to be, he has to be at the top of that list.
One of the
right?
favorites, one of the favorites, absolutely.
And I was hoping he'd enter this game just so we could say his name, have an excuse to say it. Here's Scotty Sanders, now runner in scoring position, one out. As Bobo checks into the game. Brown for Lamar with the release. Here's the pitch.
Brown this year has struggled with walking batters. He has 9 walks on the year and only 12 innings of work.
Averaging almost a walk an inning. Not something you want to see. But he's ahead right here. Excuse me, behind.
The infield is playing in right now, seeing if they can get a grounder to make sure Webb Bobo does not advance from third and scores from home.
Sanders just looking to put something in play. Thought about that one.
We'll check down to first base, and umpire says he did not swing.
2 balls, 2 strikes now on Scotty Sanders. He's 0-for-1 in today's game. Drew a walk earlier. Inside for a ball. Full count now on Sanders. 3 balls, 2 strikes, 1 out.
Good patience there for Sanders for not swinging at that breaking ball.
Foul ball, almost nailed. Webb Bobo there. Glad he was on the outside of the line. As you refer to, Sanders very patient at the plate tonight. He's a biology major. I imagine that he has to display patience a lot handling biology. 3 balls, 2 strikes. Here's the pitch. Called strike 3. Sanders thought for a second maybe he had a walk. Going to bring up out number 2.
Great pitch there by Brown. Low outside corner. One of the hardest pitches to read if you're a right-handed batter. Any pitch opposite and low away from you, definitely a hard one. And the umpire will call it strike 3.
Going to be strikeout number 13 for Brown of the season. That will be good for second among Lamar's relievers. Sanders whiffed for the 10th time this season. Here's Pace now.
The strike zone has actually changed starting this year. And the strike zone used to be from below the knee to the chest. And this year it has changed from above the knee to the chest. So it kind of limits the strike zone just a little on controversial pitches at the knee level.
Evan Pace here, he's having a good game so far. A couple RBIs. Several RBIs, actually. He's batting 286. As See the three stolen bases. Three balls now, looking to draw a walk. Gold strike there.
Another one of those knee-high pitches.
Pace got things rolling after the home run early in the game. Two-run double. Solid shot down third baseline with two outs. I'll make a play at first. For out number three, Southeastern open things up there, increasing their lead to five. Your score, Lamar 1, Southeastern 6. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back. Southeastern really opened things up. There at the bottom of the fifth, you see the bunt there that drove in two for Southeastern.
Smart, great base running there by the Lions.
Carlisle.
Getting two runs on a bunt.
And we've talked about it all night long, how that aggressive base running can win you games and put you in good situations.
May not always show up on the stat sheet, but definitely show up on the scoreboard.
Carlisle Kessler checking into the game for Southeastern. Max Groller checking out the one earned run, but we saw him getting some trouble there at the top of the fifth inning. Now bailed out by his defense. Groller second best in the conference with 39 strikeouts out of the total tonight. And here's Carlisle Kessler. For Lamar, it's been rough not being able to capitalize on what happened in the fifth inning. Runners in scoring position abandoned in several instances.
After a quick start for Lamar in that first inning, they definitely have settled down, having no runs through the next five.
Kessler finding his groove here, one ball, two strikes. And you see it there, a swing and a miss, strike three.
That's crazy.
Ball sort of wandering around the infield after the strikeout.
I think the catcher tried to throw it to third base like they normally do after a strikeout.
Did it hit somebody?
It might have hit the batter. Number 21,
third baseman. I don't know if the batter is too happy about that.
He struck out twice there. He struck out, and then after that he got hit.
He got nailed.
Hello.
Man.
Hello.
One out now. Low and away for a ball. It's number 21, Chad Fleischman, the junior for Lamar. So our junior correspondent came in here a little bit unannounced, trying to give us some insight on the game. I don't think it was too helpful, but it was, A for F.
Always nice to hear what the kids 10 and under have to say.
Exactly.
All a part of the Southeastern sound. Oh.
He was trying to help Richie. That was it.
He found Richie. He was with Richie. That's
exactly.
That explains it.
They've been chasing foul balls together. There's one high, deep to left center. It's going to stay in, though.
On the warning tracks.
Almost carried out of here. And if that would have been hit earlier in the game, it might have just gone over, but not right there. Two up, two down for Southeastern.
It's always interesting to see what the scoreboard has to play after an inning or after an out or anything. I always play some funny videos.
They definitely do. Keeping this crowd engaged. It is a nice crowd here in Hammond, Louisiana.
Huh?
The people here in Hammond do love.
Can't mess it up, huh?
Do love their baseball. Leading the conference in attendance over the course of the past 2 years is Southeastern, averaging almost 1,100 people per game.
That does not include the people in the parking garage watching
exactly.
the game over center field.
Who knows about the countless people who've seen games from the parking garage?
Pretty smart. Pretty smart move, too.
Really smart. Two strikes. Couldn't get the call there. One ball, two strikes now. Two outs.
Breaking ball just missed on the outside corner. One thing I noticed from these from the second and shortstop today is they are playing really deep.
Carlisle Kessler making a quick go of things here in the sixth inning. We've got Richie Solaris with an injury update. Richie?
Well, guys, on that last offensive series for the Lions, infielder Derek Mount was running. He felt a pain in his leg, ended up walking off the base. He's got an injury. He said he believes that he's pulled his hamstring. He said it had been bothering him a little bit this week, but all of a sudden it just popped. He says he's done for at least today, and he is very forlorn. He's not happy about it, very frustrated, but he will not return to the game today. Guys, back to you.
Thanks, Richie, for the update there, and that's never good news to hear.
Definitely not a fun injury.
Player go out. No, a pulled hamstring. Depending on how serious it is, that is not a one-day injury. Hopefully, it's just tweaked a bit, but if it is pulled, he will probably miss some significant time.
You can see the frustration on his face because he did not want to get out the game. But when it comes to an injury like that, you gotta monitor it. And I think it was a smart move by Coach Reiser and the trainer to take him out the game and replace him.
Kessler couldn't get the call there and sent a man at first base. Strike there.
That injury to Derek Mount is really crucial because that does not only take a batter out of your lineup, that takes a pitcher.
Could take a pitcher out of the bullpen.
And he's a guy I think could pitch like a normal starter on a weekday game.
Definitely not something you want to see happen, especially in a situation like that. Lamar now trying to get something going after giving up the big half inning to Southeastern, the bottom of the fifth. Fouled one off there is Grant DeVore.
Great to see him back at the plate after last at bat getting hit in behind the head.
Saw him run the bases, did just fine. Settled back down. It was a very scary moment, though, for the 5'9", 170-pound junior. He hits one deep in the center, and that's going to fall for a base hit, a single. For his second, Seward got turned around on the ball, and the runner on second thought about maybe stretching it to third, but changed his mind.
Right fielder, Cutter McDowell.
They're both eating, so you
we're back at the top of the lineup now.
Oh, how nice is that? What do you say?
Thank you.
Bryce, that was very sweet.
Cutter, that's a really unique name. Never heard of that one before.
And that's a shot. That's going to bring in a run. Left fielder firing home. Runners stay on first and second as Lamar scores their second run of the game.
And the catcher and the pitcher are not happy there. They were not on the same page. The catcher thought he probably could have got him out if the pitcher did not stop it. Or, I'm sorry, not the pitcher, the third baseman. if they didn't stop it.
Definitely saw some confusion there. So after getting the first two batters out, Lamar's found some success.
Number 20, second base.
Scoring their second run of the game.
Starting a two-run rally for Lamar.
Coker now. One of the two freshman starters for this team. Trying to get something going. The Comm Major himself swings and a miss. Two strikes on Coker now, runners on first and second. Two outs, Southeastern finding themselves in yet another pickle. Outside and away for a ball. .300 average on the season for Cole Coker. Fouls one away there. Lives to die another day.
Big spot for the freshman here. Runner on first and second, two outs. See if he can get a base hit and see if he can drive in and run on the runs.
Seven RBIs on the season for Coker.
Off speed pitch, got him.
Strike three, and they can only get one run out of it. That brings your score, Lamar 2, Southeastern 6. You're watching Lion Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel.
Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone, joined by my partner Dylan Domingue here. And Lamar has made a pitching change. Bro, a hard shot to the shortstop, trying to run it out. Close play at first, but it's going to be an out. Entering for Lamar is Nathan Gabruski.
Try saying that 10 times fast.
Gabruski. No, I'm not going to do it, but... You see Gabruski, he has pitched six innings on the year, allowed six hits, two earned runs, one walk, six strikeouts, 3.0 earned run average. Gets the first out there. Ryan Byers, the lone dinger of the game. Thought maybe with that wind coming in we'd see a lot more, but it's definitely died down. Byers took advantage of that wind early on with that leadoff home run to start off the game for Southeastern. Tie things up at one. After two runs in the second,
a little quiet for a while, and then bottom of the fifth, we saw those three runs, the two on the bunt. Southeastern doing what they do best, aggressive base running, putting the ball in play, and we've even seen a little display of power from Byers. Batting 224 on the year, two home runs, 11 RBIs, that one stolen base. He's got two balls, two strikes now. Ponchatoula product, not too far away. Swing and a miss, and that'll send him to the dugout. Catcher over through the third baseman there, a little embarrassing. But Gabruski, there gets his seventh strikeout on the season. The Southeastern Sound letting it know that
he overthrew the third baseman.
Exactly. Just get the ball back to the pitcher. That's what the fans.
Over the break, the Southeastern Sound definitely got into it for some free T-shirts. Everyone likes free items, especially T-shirts.
Where's our free T-shirt? Two balls now.
I don't think
excuse
you can
me, one
throw
ball,
it in the
one
booth.
Strike. They probably can't. We'd have to ask. But you know, look, there's been some advancements in T-shirt guns.
I was gonna say maybe a T-shirt gun can actually fire.
I'm pretty sure I can shoot one to Mississippi from here.
I think his glasses, I don't know.
Shatterproof, possibly.
Maybe so. I don't want to hurt these fans in front of us, though. I don't want to hurt the sound.
Ah, it's for a free T-shirt. You know, they you know, I think they'd be fine with it. Two balls, two strikes now on Drew Avens, the Alabama product.
Square to bunted last time. Last pitch.
Out of play. Last year, he was one of six players for the Southeastern team to have double-digit stolen bases. Just in case you didn't believe us when we said these guys are aggressive on the base path. 11 stolen bases.
Imagine that, huh? Pitcher. Over 10 stolen bases. Well, partial pitcher.
Does everything. Drew Avens. Takes the walk there.
Close call, but he will get the free base.
Carson Kreitz comes to the plate.
Number two, second baseman, Carson Kreitz.
He's another one of those guys with double-digit stolen bases last season. 13 stolen bases.
Definitely a senior leader for the Lions.
Had a 10-game hitting streak last season as well. Held from March 29th to April 12th. Hit 415, leading off an inning last season. Also earned all-conference and all-tournament honors from the Southland Conference, as well as first-team All-Louisiana in 2016. Carson Kreitz batting 286 on the season. Runner on first now. Two outs, strike right there. One ball, one strike.
Coach Reiser making a signal, too.
You see the wind picking up a bit. The flags are flailing. Branches waving. Timeout called.
Let's see if we see a hit and run here for the Lions. Let's see what Matt Reiser calls up.
It's never a dull moment with Reiser. Lulls you to sleep sometimes and then jolts you back awake. With aggressive base running. Two balls, one strike now on Kreitz. Southeastern Sound has calmed down, settled in. They've gotten comfortable. It's a beautiful night here in Hammond, Louisiana. Great night for baseball. Fouls one off right there. Two balls, two strikes.
Always a great way to spend a Friday night or any day on the weekend. Or just any day, period. Nice day at the baseball game with the family.
First game of a three-game series for Southeastern. This is their home conference series opener. Their first series taking place at home.
when their first, it comes to conference game at home was last weekend.
Exactly, against UNO, against the second UNO. Game out of that three-game series, a series they ended up sweeping from UNO.
The Poncha Train Bowl, the way it's set up is whatever team hosts it is Friday night at the home team, Saturday at the away team, and Sunday back at home. So for UNO, they had home games Friday and Sunday, and Southeastern played here on Saturday. And like you said, won all three of them.
After playing Southeastern, they played LSU and actually got a victory.
They beat them two times this year.
Pretty impressive stuff.
And Southeastern, after the series, they go to LSU this upcoming week.
Yes, on a Wednesday, heading over to Alex Box Stadium, taking the 35-40-minute drive up the road.
Number 15.
Kreitz draws the walk. Runners now on first and second. Taylor Schwanner, ever so deadly. Louisville Slugger Player of the Week last week. Five home runs, slugging 741, 28 RBIs to lead the Southland Conference. See if he can make some noise here. Fans in the stadium definitely on the edge of their seats when Schwanner enters the batter's box. Powerful hitter.
For any fans out there who are interested in miscellaneous stats, if Southeastern pulls off the win today, they will be 2-0 with these uniforms.
Uh-oh. You know, wear them more often.
Wear them more often.
Both runners stealing, and they're both going to be safe. Catcher fell asleep there. We just talked about that. Sometimes the lull of this game, you might start dozing off a little bit, and they caught the catcher napping. That'll wake you up.
Great jump by both runners, too. Definitely no play
before
at third.
Before the catcher even realized it, both runners were battling the base. A testament to the aggressiveness of this Southeastern team. Two strikes. Hit to the shortstop. Handles it well. Strike to first, and that's going to be out number three. Southeastern can't get anything going right there. That brings your score. Lamar 2, Southeastern 6. You're watching Lion Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Field, you see it there. Southeastern opened up, scored some more runs in the fifth inning. It's 6-2, the Lions over the Cardinals. So we kick off this seventh inning. Been a great ball game so far. Here's Kessler now, wind up and delivery. Ball on the inside.
Both teams have six hits, but they have had a lot of base runners. Southeastern has had the bases loaded twice this game.
Reed Russell been relatively quiet outside of that strike to right field. He had a sacrifice hit that advanced the runner two at one point. See him there, thought about swinging, but...
And I think that's where, when I talked about the strike zone changing, I think that's where it's going to have an effect. Because right there, it looked like it was at the knee. But with the strike zone change, that's why it was called a ball.
And there goes Reed to first base. Our junior correspondent's chiming in with some quality. Quality work. I mean.
Always trying to pump up the
Lions. Not many people are doing better work than those guys. You know? They put the hard hours in. They drink a juice box and they're on their way. There's a foul.
You missed it earlier. We had a animal fan come before the game started during practice. We had a stray dog.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Ran actually on the field and was running the base pads, actually.
Official team mascot.
Yeah.
Who needs a lion when you can have a stray dog? There's a strike now. Right center. It might find a gap.
It's gone. That's a home run.
It's gone.
Bounced on the yellow line at the very top of the wall. That's going to be a home run.
Two-run strike there. Brings things closer now for Lamar.
The wind helped carry that one out.
It definitely did. We've seen the wind pick up over the course of the last, let's say, 10 minutes. And it's definitely played a factor there. Carry that one over the right field wall. Kessler giving up a home run there. 6-4 now, Southeastern over Lamar.
Great opposite field power, too.
Robin Adams doing a little bit of everything out there. This is Trey Silvers. 261 hitter on this season. Fifteen RBIs. See him fight that one away right there. Robin Adams is having a solid season for this team. Came into the game batting 368, batting close to 380 now. He started every game that he's played in. 16 runs, 27 hits.
Great off-speed pitch there to strike him out. Definitely not Russell's night. Oh, not that's not Russell.
Trey Silver's there.
Yeah, definitely not Silver's night.
Number 32, catcher.
Silvers heads to the bench. Brendan Arredondo heading up to the plate. 262, batting 262 on the season.
Whenever in 2007, he actually played in the Little League World Series for the Southwest team.
Guy's been all over the place.
I'm sure that's always a great venue, the Little League World Series.
Always very entertaining.
That's where you find those junior announcers,
those junior
kids.
Correspondents.
Absolutely.
Just roaming around. Got plenty of them here tonight.
They're everywhere.
Here's Arredondo.
He was the preseason all-conference catcher for the Southland.
A lot of expectations on his shoulders coming into the season. Believe he's a transfer. Had a great year at his previous school.
From Midland College, where he transferred from.
That's going to be a walk. Carlisle's going to get a meeting from his infield. Words of encouragement. 6-4 now. We've seen Lamar etch their way back into this game with a two-run shot from Robin Adams, who's having as good a season as anyone.
Got a meeting on the mound with Coach Matt Reiser.
Our junior correspondents have found Richie. Richie, what you got for us?
Guys, Coach Reiser just sent two more pitchers to the bullpen, Bryce Tassin and Josh Green. You see Carl Lau struggling a little bit out there, so he sent those two pitchers out there to the bullpen to just start warming up, so we may be seeing a new change soon. Guys?
Thank you, Richie. And we have seen Carlisle Kessler, after fanning his first two batters in his first inning, sort of struggle since then.
That was actually a strategy by Reiser. If you go to the mound, take about a minute. The pitchers have a time in the bullpen, have some extra time to do some warm-up pitches. So it's always a strategy, actually.
See there, a big swing.
He went at a homer from himself.
Chad Fleshman, he did. Trying to take advantage of that win. Those flags are at full sail in center field. Getting a little chilly out there now. A beautiful night. Beautiful spring night here in southeastern Louisiana. Couldn't ask for a better night for some collegiate baseball. Two strikes on the batter, one out. One ball, two strikes now. Just missed on the outside there. Fleshman and RBI in the game. Takes a bad bounce off the third baseman's chest. It's heading out into left field. It's playing pinball now. He's going to sit at third. A single for Fleshman. Second time he's got on base in this game. Fans to runner to third base. And Lamar's making some noise now. Crawling back into this one. Two runs now here at the top of the seventh inning.
It's going to be an error on Schwarner at third base.
It's a solid shot. It's hard to rope in. You'd imagine that Reiser's going to make that pitching change now. One out here at the top of the seventh.
Game has definitely gotten interesting.
It definitely has. Lamar deserves a lot of credit for fighting back into this one. Huge opposite field shot from Robin Adams, who's having a great game so far.
After that first run in the top of the first, Lamar's been very quiet. And so the past few innings, they're really starting to catch fire.
Put some runs on the board. And here we are now, as Richie just told us. We're going to take a break as Southeastern makes a pitching change. You're watching Lion Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. Lamar has clawed their way back into this game behind the bat of Robin Adams. A solid shot opposite field over the right field fence for a home run. That brought this score. Lamar 4, Southeastern 6. A game that Got a little quiet there between the second and fourth innings, but crowd's definitely awake now. We've got ourselves a ball game. Southeastern made the pitching change. It's Bryce Tassan in the game, freshman.
2014, he was the perfect game underclass All-American.
Time called.
Freshman from Walker, Louisiana, Walker High School.
Peyton Robertson in the batter's box. One out, runners on first and third. Lamar looking to tie this game up. Go ahead, run at the dish. Tassan, just a freshman, fights that one away, out of play.
Another foul ball behind the screen.
Probably at the church behind us. Here's Tassan now. Took this sign, delivered the pitch, and that's his strike. One ball, two strikes on the batter now.
Good fastball at the knees.
Southeastern trying to get out of this pickle. Runners on first and third. Trying not to give up any more damage. Stop the bleeding, if you will. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Tassan sits him down for out number two here at the top of the seventh.
The sound likes that one.
They do.
Great. Great elevated heater from Tassan.
Pinch hitting for Lamar is Ryan Erickson, the sophomore outfielder entering the game for Grant DeVore.
Ryan Erickson is actually listed as a pitcher on the depth chart. He might have come in for a small appearance because his ERA is actually a 40.5.
Yeah, I see him as an outfielder here. Maybe they were just playing around late in a game or something.
Yeah.
That's quite possible.
He had one inning of work and gave up six runs.
Ouch. Runners on first and third for Lamar. Two outs. Story of this half inning has been Robin Adams' solid shot over the right field fence to etch Lamar within two runs. Erickson taking his time. Tassan gets the signal. Here's the windup and the pitch. That's right in the gap.
Right out of the reach from Brennan Brew. Try to make the diving catch.
The fifth run of the game for Lamar. Only down one now.
You can kind of feel the momentum starting to shift now. From Southeastern had it basically the whole game. And now you can start feeling shift.
Erickson, after the pinch hit, is going to check out. They're going to put in a pinch runner. Cole Girard pinch running for the pinch hitter. Runners on first and second now. Lamar making these Southeastern fans nervous. Fighting back from a 6-2 deficit. Three runs, their most profitable inning so far of this game. Carter McDowell now trying to keep things going for this seemingly hot lineup now for Lamar. Couldn't make up his mind there and paid the price.
Check swing on the inside pitch. That's always a tough one.
One ball, one strike, two outs. Top of the seventh.
Whenever you do that as a batter, you're kind of scared that ball is just going to come in and hit you on the wrist or in the hands or forearm or just anywhere like that.
And they're going to enter a pinch runner for the runner on second. It's going to be Phil Ingram checking into the game, junior infielder. Bryce Tassan trying to get out of this jam now. Giving up three runs in this inning alone, four since his entry.
Phil Ingram is one of the players on Lamar who has a stolen base this year.
Big swing. Couldn't quite make contact. Strike two. One ball, two strikes now. On Cutter McDowell. The senior right fielder.
The fans getting behind the home team here.
You hear the clapping. Couldn't get the call there. Two balls, two strikes.
That was a good pitch on a 1-2 count. Breaking ball downstairs. As long as the catcher can make a good play on it, I think it's an effective pitch.
Cutter McDowell definitely thought about it for a second before making up his mind. Toss in, checking the runner at second. Delivers one on the outside. He gets away from the catcher. Runners will advance. All righty now. Full count. Three balls, two strikes. Runners on second and third base. Another sticky situation for Southeastern.
A base hit can tie the game or give Lamar the lead, which would be the first lead they had since the very top of the first inning.
And Dylan, you spoke to this earlier. The momentum has definitely shifted in this ball game, Lamar.
It could all be changed on this pitch right here, too. That's a strike.
It definitely can.
Got him.
Strike three. So Tassan stops the bleeding, but Lamar gets themselves back in the game. Your score, Lamar 5, Southeastern 6. We've got a ball game. It's Lions baseball here on the Southeastern Channel.
Welcome back to Alumni Field as the fans participate in the seventh inning stretch. Lamar's been stretching their muscle at the top of the seventh inning, fighting their way back into this ball game. You see the shot right there. Drove in a run.
We have a fan trying to communicate with us in front of us right now.
They're definitely having a fun time here, and probably more fun than it is in that Southeastern dugout right now. You've seen a visible momentum shift in this game. So Lamar's taken hold of everything. Errant pitch there. Off the catcher's glove. Nathan Gabruski. The freshman reliever. Doing solid work.
When you and I talked to Coach Reiser before the game, he trusts the importance of winning close games. And the team has been able to do that all year long. So we'll see.
That is actually one of the first things he brought up when he talked to us, too. He said, look, this is a team that's been in some close games. And guess what? We've won all of them. All of those games that have been close after the seventh inning, they found a way to win. So speaks to the strength, a testament to the will of this Lions ball club. They have the lead. They've surrendered some runs, but let's see if they can keep things together here. Full count now on Bobo Webb, 3 balls, 2 strikes. One of the best names in collegiate baseball, Bobo Webb.
Webb Bobo?
Excuse me, Webb Bobo. Webb is actually his middle name. His first name is John. John Webb Bobo.
John Bobo.
See, it just doesn't sound the same, right?
Webb.
You got to like Webb better, and I think that's why
Webb better. Webb better. No. It sounded more confusing in my head. Never mind.
There he is now. He drew the walk on first base now.
He replaced Derek Mount when Derek Mount was injured earlier in the game.
Hoping Mount will end up being all right when it's all said and done.
Actually, we're going to have a pinch runner now for Webb Bobo.
Pinch runner for Bobo. That's number 37. That's going to be Maverick Wilhite.
Yeah,
another great name.
Another
solid name.
Replace a good name with
if
another
you were
good
allowed
name.
To spell names in Scrabble, that name is worth, you know, a decent amount of points.
Maverick.
I can assure you that.
I wonder if he's a Dallas fan. Dallas Mavericks?
Blasphemy.
That was lame. I know.
So he checks into the game for Webb Bobo. Pinch runner now. Runner on first base as Southeastern looks to extend their lead. Take it off now. Got a good jump, but he's going to be out. Great throw from the catcher there, the preseason freshman All-Southland catcher.
Southeastern
Brendan Redondo.
Southeastern had set up a bunt with a steal on the same pitch, and they were unable to get the bunt down, so it was an easy throw out to second base. Caught stealing.
Pops that one up. It's going to be out of play.
Maverick didn't stay in the game too long.
No, he didn't.
Looked like a fan got hit in the back right there on that one.
You can only hope they're all right. Taking one for the team. Some great fans out here. A lot of foul balls, taking a lot of abuse, but
always nice to go home with a souvenir.
Exactly, and a bruise.
Except when it's in your car window.
That's never good.
It's going to be another souvenir.
They've been aplenty tonight. See the wind dying down now as the flags in center field.
Came close to one of our cameramen out there. That one's going in someone's yard.
We're just abusing the streets now. Do not drive around the stadium. Do not drive around Alumni Field.
They actually shut off the road.
See, that's
on the right side.
Smart stuff. 2 strikes now.
Strike
Ryan Anders takes the cold strike 3.
On the inside corner. Great location there.
And after hitting that solo shot to start off the game, he's been relatively quiet. Drew Avins now.
Actually, Scotty Sanders.
Excuse me, Scotty Sanders. Number 27. Drew a walk. His last time at bat.
Catcher tried to frame it on the outside corner, but the umpire calls it a ball.
One ball, 1 strike now. Chips that one away for a foul ball. 1 ball, 2 strikes, 2 outs. After Webb Bobo advanced on the walk. Strike 3 there, Southeastern. Couldn't put anything together there in that half inning. Your score, Lamar 5, Southeastern 6. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. Lamar got a little too greedy right there. A strike down the third base line, trying to stretch it into a double. A fantastic throw from the left fielder, Drew Avens, throwing him out at second base. And Lamar running out of time in this game. To tie things up, here we now sit at the top of the eighth inning. Deep fly, Seward sprinting forward, waved off by the shortstop for the second out. And just like that, two outs.
I know that didn't work for Lamar, the first batter, but that's the style Lamar is. They're very aggressive, so they just weren't going to sit there at first base. He was going to try to stretch for two, and great throw there from the left fielder to get him out. Perfect throw, too.
Now, Robin Adams helped this team claw back into this game with that deep two-run shot. And they might need him again right here. Down one run, having a phenomenal game so far. Top of the eighth now, two outs.
He can tie it in one swing.
Calls time. We thought it would be Reed Russell with the displays of power tonight, but no, it's been Robin Adams, the team leader in batting average. Takes the strike there. Two strikes now.
That was a great framing job by the catcher there, Pace.
It was. Good framing can get you pitches sometimes, and that was a close one. And good framing definitely helped there. Tassan making quick work so far. Two outs, two strikes on Adams. Here's the pitch. Cold strike three.
Doesn't hesitate.
Three up, three down. As we head to the bottom of the eighth, Lamar 5, Southeastern 6. It's Southeastern baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. Lamar found their groove late in this game, and they've made it a lot more interesting than it has been. You saw the fantastic throw right there. As Cole Coker tried to stretch that out into a double. Got thrown out at second base. That was the premier play from the top of the eighth. Now here we are at the bottom of the eighth. Ryan Byers in the batter's box. Two strikes on him now.
That play last inning.
That's Evan Pace.
That play last inning by Byers, throwing him out, or actually Drew Avens, I think, throwing him out, definitely helped the momentum for Southeastern. By that time, Lamar had momentum through the past three, four innings, so that was big for Southeastern.
Strike three on Pace there. As he mumbles under his breath heading to the dugout. Here we are now, Brennan Bro. Pops one up to left field. Easy doing for the left fielder for out number two. Lamar making quick work here at the top of the eighth. Their last opportunity to tie this game up coming at the top of the ninth. They've done a great job of showing resiliency in this game. Fighting back, down 6-2. Cutting that deficit down to one. Southeastern quiet since that big three-run half inning several innings ago. And what looks to be another pop-up might cause some difficulties.
The right fielder calls it off, and that's going to be an easy out, 1-2-3 inning.
Out number three. We find ourselves heading to the ninth inning. Your score, Lamar 5, Southeastern 6. You're watching Lions Baseball here on the Southeastern Channel. Welcome back to Alumni Field. I'm Wesley Boone. Alongside me here is Dylan Domingue. We sit now at the top of the ninth inning. Lamar's final chance to tie this game up. They've fought hard here late in this game. A shot down first baseline. That'll at least be a single. Right under the glove of the first baseman for Southeastern. Number 27. Scotty Sanders.
Lamar is not going down quietly.
No, they aren't. Leadoff hitter now on first base. Only down one run now. It's number 32, Brendan Arredondo comes to the plate.
The new pitcher on the mound is Josh Green for Southeastern. From Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Parkview Baptist High School. His father played baseball at Louisiana College.
At LC, that's my neck of the woods. They played LSU, I think, last week.
They
pretty,
did.
Pretty big deal, the D3 team getting to play LSU.
Always nice to get the opportunity to play there. Alex Mack Stadium, arguably one of the best in the entire country.
Arredondo now. A shot to the shortstop, double play opportunity, and they get it. One out away from closing this ball game.
Great double play there, turned by. Is it?
Play
by Brennan Brill.
played right into it.
The Southeastern Sound rallying behind their team. One out remaining.
Lamar grasping for air here late in this game.
Phil Ingram will be the last chance for Lamar Cardinals.
Cold strike there. Two outs now, one strike on the batter. One out away from Southeastern getting their second home conference win of the series, and a great way to start off this series against Lamar. Shot right in the gap. Going to be another single.
Team is definitely resilient, Lamar Cardinals are. Definitely fought back this whole game.
We've seen it here late in this game. Lamar now has racked up 11 total hits compared to Southeastern 6. Runner on first now. Two outs. Desperation mode for the Cardinals. A big spot here for the freshman Peyton Robertson, looking to come up clutch for his team.
Miss downstairs there.
Two balls now.
Fans sitting on the edge of their seats.
Green now with the delivery. Another ball. Ball three. So runner on first, two outs, three balls on the batter. If you're a hitter, normally you know you're probably going to get something good. You are in desperation mode. Let's see if he takes it. He's going to watch it for ball four now. Runners on first and second. As the catcher comes out to have a short conference with his pitcher, Josh Green. Big situation now. Go ahead, run on first base.
I know it's late in this game, but I want to tell you, happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's Day to you, too. You know, I haven't worn green all day, and I haven't been pinched, so.
Me either. Southeastern fans.
Exactly.
Probably Southeastern fans wearing green is just normal for them.
Exactly. That's just a normal Friday for them. Runners now on first and second. Two outs. Top of the ninth inning. Lamar trying to tie this game up.
Wow. Umpire called that a strike. Maybe look like, maybe a little outside, low and outside. But regardless, called a strike.
Maybe he's ready to get out of here. Here's Green now with the pitch.
You can hear the crowd there. Definitely not.
Southeastern Sound making themselves heard. Did not like that one. High energy crowd tonight. A lot of people here. Timeout now. The fan screams at the umpire, "What more do you want?" I say, are you not entertained, Southeastern Sound? This has been a great ball game so far. Southeastern looking to close things out here. And Green now seems rattled. Two balls, one strike. Runners on first and second. Very crucial situation.
He's definitely having a hard time trying to find that strike zone. He's throwing low and outside. All three pitches so far to this at-bat.
Green now trying to get a save here. Tip that one away. Second strike. Two balls, two strikes, two outs.
Down to our last strike.
Runners on first and second. Something is happening as the fans clap their hands and stomp their feet. Creating an echo chamber of noise here at Alumni Field, trying to rattle the batter. Here's Green now. Here's the pitch.
Got him.
Swing and a miss, strike three, and that is the ball game.
All speed pitch on.